So hello and welcome back to another video in the F110 autonomous racing lecture series. And so today I'm going to dive into one of the first parts of the real sort of self-driving aspect of this course. And in particular, we are going to start by looking at perception for the 110 scale car. And that will naturally lend itself to ideas like mapping and localization, which are sometimes considered part of the perception of any self-driving car. And so previously, we had an overview of what the different hardware components on the vehicle look like. And so today we will essentially look at, how do we use the data from some of these sensors. And in particular, we will first focus mostly on the LiDAR, which is the primary range sensor that we have on the vehicle. And we'll also talk about the inertial measurement unit or the IMU. And then later in the course, so we'll have a separate discussion on camera-based perception because that's really useful in situations when there are multiple agents and the scene is very complex. So let's basically jump right into it. And I've said this before that, the common recipe or ingredients for a self-driving car are all these problems that I have listed here on the slide. So I don't care, which brand is prototyping their AV, they are all solving all of these problems or a subset of these problems. And one of the first things that any robot or any self-driving car has to do is to answer the question, where am I with respect to my surroundings? Right, so if you don't know where you are in the environment, and when I say where am I mean both in time and space, you need to know exactly, your coordinates, if you will, in some coordinate frame of reference of the world. And that's really key because you cannot do anything else unless you know your own position. And you might wonder, well, why is this even a problem? GPS can tell you where you are, but we'll get into why. GPS accuracy is not sufficient for most of the tasks for a self-driving car. So today we will mostly focus on this first question, where am I? And then later in the course, we will, once having understood how we answer this question of localization and mapping, we will get into how do you use this information to plan your own trajectory and do control. So that's what this video is about. I think it will take us maybe a couple of lectures to cover all of the perception and localization for the F110 vehicle. Okay, so let's jump into some of the sensors which are available to help with this task of localization. So the first one is what is called an IMU or an inertial measurement unit. It's actually a sort of an embedded sensing device which provides us with a lot of information. Such as the linear and angular acceleration of the car, the velocity. Sometimes it also has the heading included as part of the output. And so it's a pretty simple device which will give us the mostly the acceleration and velocity of the vehicle, and we can use it to infer the position of the vehicle as we will look into more detail in this video. So here is sort of what most of the outputs of the IMU look like. It can give us this linear acceleration around a different axis. So this is a 3D IMU, and the axis around which we can sense this angular acceleration or linear acceleration are shown is the roll axis. So your car can roll about its longitudinal axis, because as it turns, the car will bank and we can capture how much it is banking. There's a yaw axis, which is equivalent to steering the car. So left and right is considered as yaw. And the pitch is not that relevant, but if there's a bump on the road, the car can go up and down like that. And that's the pitch axis. And we can measure precisely the rate of the change of yaw, pitch, and roll. And that's what we use to integrate over time to get the position of the car. Right, so this is just a summarization of what I discussed earlier. They measure the roll, pitch, and yaw of the car, and we can get both linear and rotational accelerations. So this is one of the older versions of the hardware of the car. So it looks a little bit different than the vehicle I showed you in the previous lecture. But this is just to illustrate that you need to know where the IMU is placed. And so If it is offset from, let's say, the center of gravity or the centroid of this vehicle, you need to account for it because all your measurements are going to be with respect to the IMU. And this, in fact, is its own topic, and we'll have a dedicated lecture on rigid body transformation and transform coordinate systems in ROS. But here is how the IMU was placed in one of the older versions of the F110 car. And if you recall from the lecture about the build, we don't really have a dedicated IMU sensor. We can place one if we want, but the custom electronic speed control, the VESC, if you recall, it has an inbuilt IMU and gyro. So it will give us all of this data, without having to install another separate IMU sensor on the vehicle. So this is what the IMU ROS message type looks like. So you have a special message type called IMU.msg, and it gives us different forms of geometry messages, which you can see here: angular velocity, linear acceleration, and quaternion. Quaternions are essentially unit vectors in the rotational axis that can easily be used to infer roll, pitch, and yaw. But the primary sensor we will rely on for positioning the F110 vehicle is this 2D laser scanning rangefinder from Hokuyo. And so we use Hokuyo 4LX or 10LX based on how the car is being used. So essentially, this is like a range detector. It gives us depth information of how far is the sensor itself from different obstacles in the field of view of the sensor. And so, as I have indicated before, it is placed behind the Jetson or the main compute board towards the rear end of the car. Here is sort of a very cartoonish attempt at explaining how the LiDAR works. This is not exactly how it works, but in a sense, we are doing some computation to look at how much time did it take for a ray of this laser to travel and then bounce and reflect back to the sensor itself. So roughly speaking, that's what's being done, but this is not the precise calculation. The LiDAR actually works in a much more sophisticated manner where you are looking at interface properties and offsets rather than this, simplified relationship between distance, speed, and time. So what is happening inside the LiDAR? This picture will sort of clear it up. So if you look at the LiDAR from above, in this topographic view, inside is an electromechanical assembly where there's a laser. So it has actually a laser, and there's a warning on the side of the LiDAR that, what is the power of the laser and so on and so forth. And so this laser and this electromechanical assembly, it rotates from, one side to the other side, back and forth, very, very fast. And it can do so in what is called like a field of view of the LiDAR. So the Hokuyo LiDARs typically have a 270-degree horizontal field of view. So they do have a blind spot that they cannot sense what is behind the car, for instance, if the LiDAR is facing forward. And then this sort of the screening or the swapping of the LiDAR from, the swiping, sorry, of the LiDAR from one end to the other, it takes place in discrete increments or step sizes. And this is a property of the LiDAR that you know when you use it. And so for each of these steps, we get a measurement of what was the distance reported by the laser at that increment, right? So you can see in this picture, we are going from right to left in this picture. And so we start with step zero, which is a certain angular distance or a certain angle offset from, let's say, the horizontal plane here. And as the laser rotates, for every step we get a measurement, right? And so this angular displacement between steps is also known to us. So we know how many steps it would take for it to cover the entire field of view. So for example, for the Hokuyo 10LX, you go from 0 to 1079, so you get a 1080 measurements with a maximum range of 10 meters, as implied by this 10LX over here. So this is how the LiDAR works, and let me show you actually some data to give you a better understanding of what this measurement looked like. So what I did was I had a simple setup in my office where I set up this LiDAR. It was stationary and kept at my desk. And then this is my office is essentially a square room. And there's a whiteboard, a large wall, essentially, of a whiteboard in my office. And so what you will see is you will see me standing in front of the LiDAR. And what we see are these red dots, right? So these are the sort of the measurements reported on where that particular step size or step array reflected from. And so you can see, because this is clear line of sight between the LiDAR and the whiteboard, you get like a flat line indicating there's a flat surface. And then because I was standing right in front of the LiDAR, and you will see me move about in just a second when I replay the actual data, you can see I occlude some portion of the whiteboard. And so, you know, there's a gap here. And you can sort of see, you know, the LiDAR capturing a human. It's not clear looking at this picture, but in the following video, you can see I'm moving about with the frame of reference of the LiDAR. So here is what those, you know, 1,080 points look like. And you can see here is the, you know, this is the whiteboard right here. And I'm kind of moving about, going further closer, and also going behind the LiDAR. Had to like crouch a little bit to get outside the field of view. But you can see, you know, how I'm moving out and about in the office, and the LiDAR is able to pick all these distances. So every red square in this data is a distance reported from the center of the LiDAR for one of those rays. So we want to, you know, use this information, obviously. And so the LiDAR has its own message structure. It's called the laser scan. That's the message type that LiDARs will typically use. And so you can see how different fields of this message data structure are defined. So we have the min and the max angle of the scan. So you know what that means from, you know, you can define the minimum and the maximum angle. You can observe the increment between subsequent steps or measurements. There is the total time elapsed between scans. So a scan is like one complete swipe from one side to the other. We have the min and the max range reported, right? So the laser has a certain power. So beyond a certain maximum range, it doesn't report anything meaningful in terms of how further apart that object might be. And so we can read what the min and the max range value is. And the most important attribute reported by the LiDAR is perhaps this array called ranges, because this is where you get this array of the 1080 values, where for each value or each step, you get a reported distance at that step as reported by the LiDAR, right? So, and this value will always fall between the min and the max range. And you can get other stuff too, as things like the intensity of the signal reported back, which can be indicative of the type of surface, whether that is highly reflective or not reflected and things like that. So you can get, you know, other, you can infer other things about the objects and not just the distance itself. So this is what that array looks like. So you see this array ranges. We've just echoed a snapshot of that. And a few things to note here. First, you see a lot of these, you know, infinity kind of values. This essentially means that for that step, nothing was returned, right? So which can be inferred as saying that at that angular position, there is no obstacle for up to the max range of the LiDAR. Because if there is an obstacle, it will report the distance to that obstacle in meters. And similarly, you know, sometimes we also disregard the minimum distance because anything between zero and the minimum distance can also be disregarded. So here is another recorded file, and this time we've overlaid the image from the vehicle itself. So you can sort of correlate what you see on the right hand side in ARVIS, which is a visualization tool that we will learn more about when we get to the simulation part of this course. But you can correlate the white point cloud or the laser scan with what the hallway looks like. So let me sort of replay this. And so you can see as the vehicle drives You see the left and the right wall, then you see the wall in the front, and you see these indentations or gaps in the wall. So whenever there's a door, there's a slight indentation on the boundary of the laser scan. So it's pretty precise, and it gives us a good field of view in terms of the distance reported. And for most part, you know, the F110 tracks are like a single track with a wall on either side. And so the LiDAR behaves like a primary sensor to give us this information about where you are with respect to the, let's say, the left boundary and the right boundary, right? So I want to clarify here, this is merely a visualization of the LiDAR. I haven't yet explained how you use this data to figure out where you are. I mean, sure, you know, given this image and given the point cloud visualization, you can just eyeball and approximate that, okay, I think I'm roughly here, but you know, that's not going to be enough. We need to know precisely where we are, and that's exactly the problem of localization, right? To figure out where you are with respect to your surroundings. Right, so we have to figure out, and the self-driving car has to figure out where it is, which it's not sufficient to just say, I'm on this freeway. You need to know which lane you are in and where in the lane you are in, right? So it needs to be very precise, what we call decimeter level accuracy. So decimeter is just, you know, no more than tens of centimeters. So we have to determine the state of a robot or a self-driving car. So when I say state, I'm going to interchangeably use these terms called pose or state. And most of the time, when we look at localization, we are not just talking about the position of the car, or let's say the XY coordinates in a 2D plane, but also the heading or the orientation of the car. So we also want to know what direction we are facing. So pose is a term which combines both position and orientation or heading, and that's very commonly used to describe localization output. And then we need to define a frame of reference with respect to which we are localizing our car, right? So it doesn't make sense to say I'm at 2,5 when I have not defined where 0,0 is in the world. So that frame of reference is typically a map frame of reference or some, you know, GPS frame of reference for the full scale thing. So let's get to the question of, you know, how a self-driving car, a full-scale self-driving car for that matter, localizes itself. And the obvious thing which comes to mind is, well, why not just use the GPS, right? So we are used to using GPS. It is a global positioning system. So the name implies that you will know your position on anywhere on the globe. And while it does work for most of everyday users, it is not sufficient for the complex task of automated driving. Because remember, we don't really, you know, we are not just concerned with knowing that what street we are on and where we would like to go. That problem is solved using GPS and routing. But like I said, we need very fine-grained resolution of our own position in the world and the position of others around us as well. So really what we need is a, you know, decimeter level error. We need to localize ourselves no more than 10 or 15 or 20 at most centimeters of error, whereas GPS is not that precise. So if you just rely on the GPS satellite receiver or a GPS system in your vehicle, it has an order of magnitude more error. So, you know, we cannot resolve whether we are in our lane or in the oncoming lane if we just rely on the raw GPS signal. Now, there have been advances in GPS, and there's sometimes, you know, sometimes there's some special kinds of real-time positioning systems, GNSS, RTK systems, which can provide a finer level of accuracy, but they require usually additional infrastructure to be present in order to do that. And so here, this 2 to 10 meter error is what is the average error for a usual GPS signal that you and I will use on our phones, for instance. And so that's not enough, right? Because we need to know where we are, and regular GPS doesn't cut it. So in the remaining video, I'm going to talk about two methods to get to this precise level of accuracy. The first one is going to use essentially the IMU data. But to understand that, we will need to understand the concepts of a technique called dead reckoning. And so we will go over that method of dead reckoning. I'll give you some examples. And then we will see how you can do dead reckoning for your localization or odometry calculation. And then we will get into how do you incorporate the LiDAR information, especially on the 2D scale for the F110 car. So to sort of motivate this discussion, we all are familiar with the use of GPS now, but I'm wondering if you have ever thought of what did vehicles use before GPS was around, right? So just to be sure, automobiles were invented much before the GPS satellites were deployed. But people have had to navigate for the longest time. Yes, you could always rely on a manual map and kind of look at landmarks and see where you were. Before GPS was around, there were some semi sort of automated systems which could give you your rough position on which street you were and whether it's the time now to make a left turn or a right turn, kind of like a proxy for GPS without really using any satellite information. And so it uses a concept called odometry or dead reckoning. And to motivate an example of what is dead reckoning, I'm going to play a little clip from a TV show which explains how old navigation systems before GPS was invented used to work in automobiles. So let's first just watch this together, and then we will jump back into dead reckoning.
Okay, so check this out. The 1990 edition of the Mazda Yunos Cosmo looked like just about any other car, but it was the beginning of a new era. It contained the world's first onboard hands-free navigation system. But long before 1990, people were looking at ways to track your position while traveling in a vehicle. I dug around and found a couple of early contenders. This is the wristlet. It's some kind of scrolling map, which is pretty cool. And there's this, an odometer-like disc, which is all fairly promising. And then I find this from the Milan Trade Fair. 1932, the Iterato. Looks like a GPS, it's fitted to the dashboard. It gives you information about things like crossroads, bridges, level crossing. So I'm trying to figure out how this thing works. And when I blow up this photo, I can see that there's a cable trailing into the footwell of the passenger side. That cable must be linked to the front right wheel. So every revolution of the wheel would scroll the map forward, keeping it exactly in sync with where you are in the real world. But could it really have worked? There's only one real way to find out. I gotta build the sucker and test it. So we have little drive shafts. I'm enlisting some help from builder John Marcoux. We have to create a device that basically scrolls paper from one side to the other, which is the map. And it has to correlate with the speed of the car so that the map moves as the car moves.
We're gonna have to slow down the rotations. There's got to be something inside the speedometer that adjusts according to how fast the car is going.
Yeah, we're gonna have to get a little creative here because we're just working with some black and white pictures.
Sounds good.
First challenge, the shafts and feeding mechanisms for the scrolls. Screw these up and we'll be in paper jam hell. All right, now to put all this stuff in it. Challenge two, hook up a tiny gearbox. It's gonna slow down the revolutions of the paper feed so that I can actually see the map coming by, otherwise it would just shoo, shoo, shoo. Last time someone tried to find their way using this system, FDR was president, and King Kong was a new release. Well, it looks cool.
Yeah.
So before we hit the road, we're doing a shop test by connecting a motorized wheel to our in-car navigation system. The moment of truth.
Okay,
The wheel and map are synchronized, meaning even when driving fast, the map should move slowly enough to read.
So that was pretty interesting, right? This sort of hands-free navigation. Essentially, it uses the rotation, the knowledge of the rotation of the wheels of the car to scroll this this map. And it's using the principle that by measuring your own motion, you can estimate how far you have gone in the real world, right? That's really the heart of this entire concept. So yeah, I really like that video. I hope it gives you a fresh perspective of how things were done and what are the roots of automotive navigation. So they use this system called dead reckoning for localization. And so that's what we'll spend some time trying to understand the intuition. And I'm going to first explain the system without really talking about whether it's an IMU sensor or something else. And then we will, you know, look at how we can use this in the F110 vehicle. I'm a big fan of trivia, if you haven't figured that by now. But I always wondered why it's called dead reckoning. I didn't really find a conclusive answer, but there are some good candidates for why this approach is called dead reckoning. Some say that this is from deduced reckoning, so sort of makes sense, but I don't think that's the right reason. Dead ahead reckoning means, you know, it's sort of it's trying to capture that you are estimating where you are going, and there's a phrase, go dead ahead. So maybe it derives from that. The one that I like the most is probably the third one, where most of these navigation concepts and localization concepts, they find their roots in ancient sort of maritime and seafaring language, because that's really how localization methods were developed, by sailors who were in the middle of the ocean and need to figure out where they were with respect to major land masses. So the word dead may have referred to that you could estimate the position of your vessel in the ocean as long as the waters were relatively still, or dead waters, because there's then no drifting or draft, that's going to cause an error in your estimation. So if you knew your course and you knew your speed and the waters were dead, then you could use dead reckoning to estimate where you were depending upon how long you have been sailing. So I like that one the most. So I know we are digressing a little bit, but I thought it was worth mentioning why this is called dead reckoning. So let's get back to how do we use it, right? So there's many ways to do dead reckoning. Like going back to that video we just saw, we want to use the knowledge of how fast or how much the wheels of the vehicle are rotating. And among many sensors, one of the sensors that we use is called a wheel encoder. And what it is a very simple device. It's literally this disc with the uniformly spaced holes in it. And so this disc goes on to the axle and it connects to the wheel itself. And then as the wheel rotates, there is this special circuitry. So you see this board right here. It has a infrared receiver and a transmitter, and you can see there is this gap between the receiver and the transmitter, and this gap is wide enough for this disc to rotate inside. And so the idea is that when you mount this properly, as the wheel rotates, the beam between the IR receiver and the transmitter, it's going to be continuously blocked and then opened and then blocked and then open. And by counting these pulses, right? So every time there is a connection between the receiver and the transmitter, you will observe a pulse in your software or from your microcontroller to which this circuitry connects. And so by counting the number of pulses, let's say per unit time, we can estimate the speed of rotation of each of the wheels to which this assembly has been mounted. Right, so not only that, if we had two of these, we could also distinguish between the direction of rotation, whether it's clockwise or anti-clockwise. So this is one of many methods with which you could estimate how fast or how much the wheels have turned. And if you knew that, you just multiply that number with the circumference of the wheel, so 2 pi r, and that will give you the linear distance that that wheel has traveled in that amount of time that you have measured using the encoder. So pretty simple idea and very standard way to look at what is called odometry, which is a way of measuring the distance traveled by the wheel. So let's look at an example of how you can use this information to estimate your position in the real world. So let's say we have a coordinate system which defines my environment. So I have a capital X and capital Y. This is my frame of reference in which I'm trying to estimate the position P of my robot, right? So this is the origin here. And at a certain time, I know that my robot is located at position P. A small detour over here. When we say that a robot is present at a certain position, what do we really mean by that? Because a robot is not a point mass, right? It has a physical geometry and a dimension. So in robotics, it's typical to either use the centroid or in some cases the center of the axle, the driving axle or the rear axle of the robot as that frame of reference. And later in the course, you will see me use this term called base link. And base link usually refers to that center of the axle of the robot. So when we say the robot is present at a certain location, what we mean is that the center of the rear axle of the robot is at that location. And we understand that there's a real footprint and a geometry of the robot around that single point. So that's just a sidebar over there, but let's get back to the task at hand. We have a robot which is present at position P, and using, let's say, wheel encoders, we measure that the left wheel has moved a distance delta SL and the right wheel has moved a distance delta SR. Okay, so this is what we can measure using the wheel encoder assembly that I just described. And so the question is, if you knew the distance traveled by each of the wheels and you knew the position of the robot in this global frame of reference, can you figure out the new position P prime after the wheels have traveled this distance? Right? That's the sort of the simple problem. And this is the problem of localization. So what is the new position P prime? If we knew P and if we knew certain attributes about how the robot has moved, which is delta SL and delta SR. So how do we quickly solve it? I'm going to show you some. It's time for some math and some geometry, but it's pretty straightforward. So just geek out with me for a bit. So to understand this, we first have to recognize that we can assume that the robot has traced some arc of a larger circle. It's traveling around some arc with a constant radius. And we are given sort of the inside measurement and the outside measurement of that arc. And we need to know how much has the center of the robot traversed if we know the inner and the outer distances. So we can assume that, you know, they have sort of moved by some amount, let's say delta theta in this case. And we know the relationship between the angular displacement and the radius is what is the length of the arc, right? So that's from some basic geometry. So here is a much more elaborate picture. So let's assume that the constant radius along which the robot has traveled is capital R. So we don't know what R is. We are just assuming that this is some this is the constant radius. What we do know is the width of our robot. So let's say the width of the robot is 2 times L. Why 2 times L and not L? It'll be clear because it's easier because the math will work out. You can assume L and L on either side of the centroid. So the width of the robot is 2 times L. The angular displacement is alpha, let's assume. And the constant radius along which it traverses this arc is capital R. So using this, we can say that R times alpha is the length of the inner arc, right? So we are talking about this line right here. And so this relation follows from geometry. then we can also say that the outer wheel is traveling at the same angular displacement alpha, but the radius is r plus the width of the robot. So that's why we have the second relation over here. And from this, it also follows that the center would have traveled using the radius r plus half of the width of the robot times the same angle alpha. So in all of this, especially in the equations, let's say this is equation one and equation two, we have two unknowns. So we have unknown r and unknown alpha, and we have two equations. And L is known to us because that's the width of the robot. So we have two equations, two unknowns. We can solve for both r and alpha in this case. And once we know r and alpha, we can easily compute delta s because that's r plus L times alpha. So I think the next few slides just walk through very basic algebra. Essentially what is going on is we begin with equation one, r alpha is equal to delta sl. And then if you expand this equation, you will get that delta sr is, r alpha plus 2l alpha. And here we can say that L times alpha is delta sr minus r alpha by 2. We can substitute the value of r alpha from this equation. And so we get L times alpha is that. And so this would give us alpha is this expression divided by 2L. Okay, so we have solved for alpha. Once we've solved for alpha, we can solve for R using any of these equations. So if we run through the math, I won't go over every step again. What we find is that the length of the arc traversed by the center, which is R plus half the width of the robot times the angular displacement, this is governed by this expression, where it's the distance traveled by the left wheel plus the right wheel divided by 2. Actually, we could have avoided all of this just based on intuition. It makes sense that the distance traveled by the center is the average of the distance of each wheel. Okay, so that geometrically just makes sense. If your robot is a rigid body, meaning that the width of the robot is not changing and it's not made out of jello, which squishes and these robot distances change, then this intuitive relationship should have held even before we did any calculation. But it just helps to know that everything checks out. Okay, so we now know exactly how much further has the robot traveled from P to P prime. Note that we don't know the coordinates of P prime. We just know that P prime is a distance delta S arc away from the original position P. So remember how I said that the pose of a robot is both its position and its orientation. So not only do we need to know how much have we traveled along this arc, we also need to know what is our new orientation, right? Where are we facing now? Earlier, let's say we were facing the horizontal plane. Now that has changed by some angle alpha. In fact, convince yourself that the change would be equal to this angular displacement of the arc around which you have traversed, right? So I'll give you some food for thought to convince yourself that that's going to be the case. So, but we already have solved for alpha previously, right? So we know alpha in terms of our known things, which is delta SL, delta SR, and the length of the robot or the width of the robot. So alpha is known to us. So we also know the heading or the change in the orientation of our robot. And that's what is shown here. And here it's also shown that you can solve for R. But we all already knew that we could do that because we know both R, we know alpha, and there are no more unknowns in this equation. Okay, so we've already computed that alpha, which is same as delta theta, would be given by this expression. So are we done though, right? So the question was to get the coordinates of P prime. So let's recap what we know so far, right? So we know that there is this global frame of reference with say 0, 0 as its origin. We know the position P prime in the global frame of reference. So what does that mean actually? So let me draw. That means that, this is not P prime, this was just P. That means that the original position P was some x comma y position in this global frame of reference. And what we want to determine is the coordinates of P prime. So P prime, let's say, is some x prime comma y prime. That's, and this is just the coordinates, but we also need to determine how much we have moved, what is the angular displacement, and this quantity is what is called the pose of the robot. So we've already determined this based on our previous discussion, that this angular position is the same as the change or the angular displacement around the arc with which you have traveled. So we know that. We know that delta S is the curve that the center has traced. And so if we knew the displacement delta D, then we could calculate, you know, the new coordinates of our robot. Okay, so we have delta theta, we have delta S, and we need to calculate the global coordinates of the pose of the robot P prime. So here is where you could do many things, but one of the easiest things to do is we can compute the if we knew delta D first of all, then we could just compute delta Y and delta X, because we can use this right angle triangle information. We know what the angle of this right angle triangle would be, and so we can use this geometry to calculate that the displacement of the robot, remember I'm using displacement not the distance, of the robot on the x-axis is this component of delta t given by this angle, and the displacement along the y-axis is delta d and the sine component of this angle, right? So here we know delta theta. Theta is the original pose or the original position of the robot. So we assume we know theta as well. And so the only thing we don't know here is the displacement delta D. And what we are going to assume is that if the length of the arc is small enough, like the motion of the robot is small, then we can assume that delta D is approximately equal to delta S. So we are essentially saying for small values of delta S, this difference between the displacement and the curvature can be assumed to be negligible. Okay, so that's the simplifying assumption of this setup. And in doing so, we essentially just replace delta D with delta S. So why would this be the case? Well, one thing I haven't explained is the role of time in all of this, right? So usually the wheel encoders, they run at very high frequency. So they run at, let's say, 50 hertz. So you are getting 50 measurements of how fast the wheel is moving every second. And so in that time, even though we are assuming that it is tracing some part of the arc, so this is like a super zoomed in view of a single measurement of the encoder or something like that, or even if you are doing it like once every second, the chances that this is a very aggressive arc are less. And that's why this simplifying assumption holds for low values of delta S, right? So if another way to think of it is if delta S is comparable to the width of the robot, then this assumption is pretty true. And so in doing so, we can now determine both the displacement of the X and the Y along the X and the Y axis. We already know the position. So we know the updated pose P prime is going to be given by the original X plus delta X, the original Y plus delta Y, and the original theta plus delta theta, right? So this is the updated position of my center of the rear axle of the robot. And all I did was use the information of what is the width of the robot and what is the distance traversed by the inner and the outer wheel. Okay, so it's pretty impressive that you can just sort of use basic geometry to figure out where you are with respect to where you were in this global frame of reference just by using the wheel encoders. So this is how really dead reckoning works. So I hope that was clear and you know, straightforward enough on how these calculations occurred. To just bring it in some generic terms, here is really what we did in the previous example, but now I'm you know, not talking about a specific wheel or thing like that. So we have a global frame of reference, which is called G0. And inside this frame of reference, I'm given the position of the robot or the pose of the robot given by GI. So the pose GI comprises of the X coordinate XI, Y coordinate YI, and the orientation phi I, right? So this is the pose of the robot at location I, which is represented by GI. And so all this this pose is with respect to the global frame of reference or the origin G0. Then the robot moves. The robot moves along some, in the frame of reference of GI, so you can see the blue coordinate system here, the robot moves a certain distance XIJ along this axis and a certain distance YIJ along the other axis. And then we want to figure out the pose GJ of the robot, which would be this updated position XJ, YJ, and we want to figure out what is, you know, phi j. Whereas what we know from a previous calculation, we know that given p, we can calculate p prime because we can always calculate the x, delta x, and delta y coordinates. You know, remember how this was the delta d stuff. So we just solve for this, but now this is a generic calculation to say, given you know gi, and given you know XIJ, YIJ, and the relative orientation psi ij, can you calculate pose GJ? And so from geometry in more general form, what follows is that the new position GJ in the global frame of reference is given by XJ, YJ, and phi j, which is the previous position GI, which is XI, YI, phi I, plus some rotation matrix that we will cover in a subsequent lecture, times the relative displacements with respect to j, right? So this is gij. This is the relative position of j with respect to position I, which is the component xij, yij, and psi ij, or phi ij, right? So there's a inconsistency in nomenclature here. Right, so I think there's an error in notation here. This should be phi ij. Okay, so in generic terms, and this is where, you know, at the beginning of the course, I said you need to feel comfortable with matrix algebra, because we won't be solving all those equations that we just solved previously. We would be using just these matrix relations, right? So we will have essentially a transformation and a translation matrix that you input any measurement of relative displacement, and it'll give you the coordinates in the global frame of reference. So look at this and spend some time trying to think about, you know, why this is true. The other thing I want to quickly point out is we very conveniently assume that the measurements of our wheel encoders, which eventually translate into the delta x and the delta y from the previous example, they were precise measurements. But that's never going to be the case, right? So if your wheel hits a bump, or if it skids and slips on the surface, you are going to lose that precise measurement of how fast or how much it has turned. And so really this equation is incorrect, because these relative displacements, they have error terms in it, right? So we are only somewhat sure of how much we have traveled with respect to our previous position and how much we have rotated with respect to our previous pose. And so there's errors in each component of the relative movement of the robot. And the sad part is that there's no way to correct these errors. We don't know how much error is getting introduced, because there is no way of having feedback to correct this error. And so this is one of the biggest limitations of dead reckoning, right? So that these errors, they integrate over time. And so we began with using wheel encoders as the way to determine position, but all of the previous story will hold true even when your primary sensor is not a wheel encoder, but an IMU. And remember that on the F110 vehicle, we have a VESC which has an IMU, which is telling us the linear acceleration and the angular acceleration. And so from physics, we know that if you integrate acceleration, you get velocity. And if you integrate velocity over time, you get position. And so using the data from the IMU, we can convert that into this relative delta X and relative delta Y from the previous example. So we can use IMU to do odometry and dead reckoning as we were using the wheel encoders, right? So in this case, you are directly going to be calculating how much the center has moved, because let's assume the IMU is placed at the center of the robot. And the point I'd previously made was that we would never have an exact measurement, right? So there's going to be noise which creeps into the IMU, then you integrate and that noise is amplified, and it's amplified even more when you infer position. So this is what is typically called in robotics or in control, open loop estimation, right? You are estimating some variable. In this case, that variable is pose. So it's position plus heading. But there is no way to correct for these errors because you don't have a separate source of measurement that is telling you that your other estimate from sensor number one is, you know, drifting away. So open loop estimation means that the error gets accumulated over time. There is no way to correct for that error. And here's like a visualization of that. So let's say you start at some known position P in the global frame of reference. And as you move, even though you are estimating, you know, P prime and P double prime and so on and so forth, using the rotation matrix that we just saw, what is happening is that there is increased error around your estimate, right? So your estimate is your best guess, but the region within which you may fall, it keeps increasing because any error keeps getting accumulated. So after even about, let's say, 10 or 20 such errors, your possible position is in such a large area around your estimate. So it's actually like sort of useless or meaningless because your robot could be anywhere in this region. And so you have lost this idea, which we started with, that for a self-driving car, you need, you know, decimeter level precision. And so if odometry is the main way with which you are estimating your position, then it's going to accumulate errors over time, and we need a better way to fix these. So the uncertainty keeps on increasing, and what we would like is to contain this uncertainty, as is shown in this picture, right? So we want some feedback mechanism. We want to know that as we estimate a new position, is the error large enough, or is there a way to reduce our uncertainty of the position at any different point? And so what we would like is the left-hand side picture of our estimate of the position with no heading errors. And we want to avoid this explosion of uncertainty around our estimated position. Okay, so the question really is that, can we use another sensor to inform us and help us with our position estimate besides just this IMU and odometry or dead reckoning based solution, right? So the answer obviously is yes, and there's no points for guessing what sensor we might be using. We will be relying on the data from our LiDAR to also estimate our position, and that's really going to be the focus of the next phase of this localization and perception part of the course, where I will explain first the intuition, and then we will have to go into a lot of math to understand how we can use the point cloud or the laser scan messages from the LiDAR to also estimate the position of the F110 vehicle. Okay, so we want to know where we are within tens of centimeter level accuracy for the full scale car. For the F110 car, it's even more precise. I think it's like 4 centimeter or 3 centimeter accuracy. And so this is where we talk about the concept of using maps as well. But before we get to that, I want to just give you a high level idea of how this might work. So this is actually a screenshot of one of the open source full-scale self-driving stacks called AutoWare. And we might touch upon a little bit more details about AutoWare much later towards the end of this course. But you can see AutoWare has the very familiar blocks or functioning blocks of localization, of perception, and mapping itself. And so these three things together will help us solve this decimeter level accuracy problem. So, this is different from doing localization or mapping in the sense that we are used to doing that, right? So when we think of a map, we think of this sort of Google Street map layout where we have a origin and destination, and there's a route planned or multiple routes planned between the origin and destination based on the traffic information and things like that. But for the complicated task of automated driving, we don't use such coarse grain maps. These are not sufficient to do this decimeter level accuracy. So self-driving uses special types of maps called HD map or high definition map. And don't get confused, like high definition doesn't mean the resolution is like 1080p or 4K or, it's not about the pixel resolution. High definition maps are specially built for the task of automated driving because they have many, many information layers present on the top of the map and which help us with the task of driving. So to give you an example, let's say this is the street view or the Google map view of the world. A high definition map would add on top of this layers of information which contain semantic information, right? So they will say each lane will have a specific layer defined. So this will be lane 1, lane 2, lane 3. We would know exactly the locations of the traffic lights, of traffic signs, of the zebra crossings. We will have rule information that this lane is, right only lane, and things like that. So this is an additional layer of information on top of the regular map, which self-driving cars would need in order to understand where they are in the world, right? So we have semantic knowledge or layer embedded on top of the geometric layout. So things like speed limit and traffic rules can be embedded. And so, again, our goal is to localize ourselves with the centimeter level accuracy, which is the difference between, the self-driving car thinking that it's parked in the spot versus, it's actually parked outside on the street or on the curb. Okay, so in a nutshell, with a combination of maps, HD maps, I'll show you some examples today, but we'll get into, we'll get into more details of how HD maps work in a subsequent lecture. I'm going to show you how to bring all this together and solve this centimeter level localization problem using data from the laser or the LiDAR through a method called scan matching. So let's look at what is the key idea behind scan matching. So here's a thought experiment. Let's say I have a pre-built map of the world that is given to me by some oracle. And so that's what this map looks like. And then I give you a piece of a puzzle and I ask you, can you tell me where in this map is this puzzle piece from? In other words, can you figure out which part of my known view of the world, which is in blue, which part of the map correlates with this small nugget of information shown in green? And so in this thought experiment, if you give it a few seconds, it's not that difficult to determine that this puzzle piece is coming from this portion of the map that I already have. And so we were able to do this very easily because we were able to look at what we currently see, which was the green piece, and then able to assess where in my stored map is the highest correlation between the green puzzle piece and, you know, the layout of the map. That's really what we did. And we didn't even have to put a lot of effort in doing that, because humans are pretty good at this sort of pattern recognition game. So this is really the idea behind what is called scan matching, right? You can think of the green puzzle piece as my current scan of the environment. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to match where does this current view of the world correlate with my previous view of the world. And if I can do that, I will have a sense for how am I traveling in the world itself. So what a self-driving car does, and we are still talking intuition here, not some formal math, it looks at different landmarks, right? So buildings don't move from day to day. Yes, there would be like construction zones and some things will change and, you know, new construction will come up. But there are enough landmarks that we can look at through various sensors, through radar, through LiDAR, through depth camera, through RGB cameras. And we get all this information. So this is what we can you know, have different modalities of sensing that we can combine. And what we are trying to do is we are looking at what my self-driving car currently sees as a collection of landmarks at any given time. And I'm trying to correlate where in the map does this current view make the most sense? Where is the highest correlation with my previously known view of the world? And that highest correlation will give me my position, because if I can overlay this landmark precisely with a known landmark, then it tells me where am I in the world, because, you know, I know where the landmark was previously. So this is very, very high level. We'll get into the nitty-gritty in just a second, but this is very, again, you know, similar to what I said earlier. Many of these concepts can be traced back to maritime navigation. This is really like how sailors used to navigate, by looking at patterns of constellations in the night sky. And over days or over weeks, they could measure how they have traversed relative to the known position of these constellations. And that would, you know, backtrack to give them their estimated position in the middle of the ocean in some sense. Right, so we've been using this concept for the longest time since navigation originated, but it's just that we've gotten very, very good at measuring these features and determining this correlation. So the key idea behind doing this is what is called scan matching. And hence, essentially, you can think of scan matching as doing audiometry, but using the LiDAR. To keep this video, you know, not too long, I'm just going to give you an intuition for what scan matching is, and then we'll look at more details of the algorithm in the subsequent lecture. So let's jump right into it, right? So the setting of the problem is the following. We have our, let's say, F110 vehicle in a corridor, and the corridor has a left wall and a right wall. And for the purpose of this simple example, we won't even bother with the right wall. We only want to look at the left wall. So how does F110 see the world? I just showed you an example earlier that we perceive our surroundings in terms of this point cloud, right? So remember how I showed you some laser scan recorded messages a bit earlier. So let's say we have our first scan at some time t, and that would look something like this. This is what we would see in our ROS RViz data view, where, remember, each of these is a reported distance for a particular step size. And since we are not worried about the right wall, I haven't considered the entire field of view. It doesn't affect the problem in any way. So let's now start mapping this into our calculation of audiometry and the coordinate systems that we just looked at. So here's another view of this world. I've removed the right-hand side wall. And what I'm saying is there's a global reference frame. So this is my frame of reference of the world, let's say 0, 0. And in this frame of reference, the F110 car has this position psi naught at some time t naught, let's say. So the green psi naught is the position of the car in the global frame of reference. At the same time, the LiDAR is reporting this scan one, S1. S1 is this scan or the collection of these laser scan points. So we know that the scan that we see is a function of where the car is in the world, right? That sort of makes sense, that what you see depends upon where you are. And if you look at the color scheme, I have indicated that the car has its own coordinate system, and the scan or the data reported is in the coordinate system or the reference frame of the car, right? So the scan information is with respect to the LiDAR, which let's say is located on top of the car. So we get S1 in the frame of reference of the car, but we know that this is a function of the known position of the car. So good so far, this is the setting of the problem. And this is what we need to know for scan one. Then the interesting thing happens, okay? The car moves and we get a new scan, S1, again in the frame of reference of the car itself, right? So this S1 is a new set of point clouds as is shown here. And this is what we get at time one, or you know, when the car has advanced. And the question is, given S1, or given this new scan, can we figure out where we are in the world? So to recap, we know what our previous scan was, then the car moved and we got a new scan, and I want to use this information of the new scan to estimate how have I moved from this psi naught to my updated position in the world. So why is this hard? This is hard because I need to know, you know, where am I facing? Am I facing right? Am I facing left? How far have I, how further apart have I moved from where I was before? Okay, I hope the setting of the problem is clear. We had a scan when we were at a known position. We get a new scan at some time later, and we want to use this new scan information to estimate our new position in the world, because we don't know where we are in the world anymore because the car has moved. And we are not using any dead reckoning or IMU stuff here. Okay, we're purely trying to estimate our position based on this laser scan data. And so here is where the idea of scan matching comes in, which we have just covered the intuition for. The idea is that the most likely position of my car is the one which leads to the maximum overlap between scan two and scan one. There's a typo here, right? This is scan two. I hope it's not that confusing. So this is what we just did with the puzzle piece. We are doing the exact same thing here. I know where I was and I know what the scan looked like at scan one. So if I can overlap or correlate my scan two with scan one, the best overlap will result in my most likely position. Meaning, if I can match parts of my subsequent scans, that will likely give me my most likely position on how I have moved with respect to where I was, using nothing but this laser scan information. So this is exactly what scan matching is. And we will, like I said, go into a lot of detail of how do you do this overlap, how do you figure out, you know, how much of the scan to overlap, and all these other questions that you may have. And so we will study an algorithm called CDDT, which is a type of a particle filter. And if you haven't heard this before, that's fine. I'm going to teach you how this works. Okay, but I hope that the intuition is clear. We just overlap subsequent scans, and the best overlap will give us our likely position of the F110 vehicle in the corridor. Okay, so to close off, let me show you some examples of how this works for the full-scale car. So here is an example of a 3D laser scan point cloud. So remember, on the F110 car, we are just using a 2D point cloud. So our laser scan data is just dots on a 2D plane. For the real vehicles, we use 3D LiDARs, which can have a vertical range as well, rather than a horizontal range. So you get a very dense point cloud of these millions of points rather than the 1,080 that we had to deal with. So this is what that raw data looks like. You can, you know, you can even pick up many, many landmarks and artifacts, and trees are also landmarks. Then this is your sort of geometric view of the world. Remember how I said that high definition maps can be built to assist with the task of self-driving. So here is what that layer looks like on top of this point cloud layer, right? So we manually, let's say, annotate different lanes and their traffic rules and directions and speed limits and the double yellow line or the dotted line and where the traffic signs are. So all of this information is also used by the car to figure out how to drive. And this is the semantic layer on top of this HD layer, right? So this is just an animation to show what that looks like and how you are getting to this high definition view of the world. And then when the car drives, it is using scan matching. So this is like LiDAR based scan matching. You can see the white points are the fresh scans that are coming in, whereas the blue and the yellow scans are your historic map that you have built, similar to what I just showed you in an HD map. So you're constantly trying to overlap what you see with what you know about the world, and that is giving you your estimated position of the vehicle in the world. Here's another example. You can see this is a car, and all these yellow landmarks are what you are trying to use for scan matching. So there's some, you know, infrastructure here, there's some trees or some other landmarks there that you are using to estimate the position of the car in the world, along with, you know, information about different lane markings and the semantic layer on top of that. So this is a very, very quick view of HD maps for localization. We will definitely have a more deeper discussion on HD maps after we have covered scan matching. So with that, I'm going to stop here. This is all I wanted to cover. It's become a pretty dense video where we looked at the two primary sensors on both the F110 car, the IMU and the LiDAR, how we can use either to do some kind of odometry, but in reality, we fuse information from both. Remember how I said that you want to minimize uncertainty of one sensor. So if you knew where you were from scan matching, you can use that to correct your error for the IMU and vice versa. And so that's sort of what we do in the F110 world. We fuse this information together to get a precise measurement of odometry of a vehicle on the track. So in the next video, I'm going to dive a lot deeper into the mathematics of scan matching, which will clarify a lot of your doubts in terms of how we are correlating this with the previous position or with the map itself. And then that will lend itself to the next topic of building a map for the F110 car. The other thing I want to say is we are now in the part of the course where we will switch to the F110 simulator. So I will send out an announcement on what to install, how to get access to the simulator. And I will also ask you to divide yourself in teams, because from now on, you will attempt the assignments in terms of your group and the racing team, because that's sort of how the remainder of the course is organized. So let me end here. This was the part one of localization and perception for F110. And we will pick up from scan matching and more details in the next video. I'll see you there.